I was off this way.
I will never win. Hey there, Kazen here, and welcome back to Always Doing. We're coming up onto a wonderful time of year, Nonfiction November, which is an event that's run by Olive over at A Book Olive. I will leave a link to her announcement video down below. There's also a Twitter and an Instagram and all other places you can get connected. And the idea is to read more nonfiction than you normally would. If you don't read any, read one book. If you normally read about half nonfiction, shoot for something a bit higher than that. And to help spur everyone along, there are some prompts. They're not required, but it's fun to think about them. And the way that she does it every year is they're really wide and open. So I'm going to link recommendations videos that I've done in past years. And even though the words are different, I bet you could fit those books into this year's prompts as well. This year, the words are collection, industry, treatment, and style. And I have two books to recommend for each of them. If you are a longtime viewer, don't worry, I have some books I don't think I've ever talked about on the channel before. And if you're new, hello, welcome, please subscribe down below. I talk about nonfiction all year round. So let's get straight to the recommendations. First, for collection, I take it quite literally with Charleston Syllabus, Readings on Race, Racism, and Racial Violence. This is edited by Chad Williams, Kadada Williams, and Keisha Blaine. In 2015, there was a horrific shooting, a massacre, where a white man went into a black church with the expressed intent of killing black people. And in the wake of that, a hashtag came up on Twitter called Charleston Syllabus, and people recommended all different kinds of articles, historical documents, books, talking about white-black racism in the United States through history and throughout time, because this is not a new thing. So this book takes those documents, excerpts from some of the longer ones, and puts them together with all kinds of context. Each chapter starts off with a historical overview of whatever period is being talked about. And then you get into the documents themselves. It might be a first-person narrative from an enslaved person, followed by the text of a song that they might have sung in the fields, followed by a scholarly analysis of the historical period. If you want to understand racism in the United States, both where it started and why it looks like what it is today, this book is a must. There were so many things that I wish were put in front of me in school, whether it was the work of Ida B. Wells, who is an amazing investigative journalist, to the Constitution of the Confederate States. There's an annotated version here that I learned so much from. It is incredibly well put together, wonderful, and underappreciated. I don't see anybody else on BookTube talking about it, and I highly recommend it. The other book I have is a different kind of collection, The Fire Inside, Firefighters Talk About Their Lives by Steve Dolson. There was a thread on Metafilter way back in the day, if you remember what Metafilter was, and it was along the lines of what single book is the best introduction to your profession, and a firefighter said this one. What the author did is he talked to all different kinds of firefighters from all over, well, the US, I'm assuming, not only like volunteer firefighters, but professional firefighters, wildland firefighters, even paramedics, people who are attached to fire departments in some areas, but maybe don't fight fires themselves, and asked them for their stories. And there's little snippets from each one. They're not credited. He gave them the anonymity so they could speak freely. And every single like paragraph from this is from somebody else. And the way he put it together is kind of ingenious because it's by different subject areas, like what training is like, or what it's like at a really bad fire, like some of the worst experiences you had, some of the best experiences you had. And he orders it in such a way that, of course, there's some gut-wrenching stuff. Like, people die in fires. These firefighters see horrendous, awful things. But they're also, number one, funny. There's a bit of gallows humor in here. And there's some great moments as well. And they're scattered throughout in a way that doesn't make it as gut punch, as much of a gut punch as it could be, even though there's still tons of gut punches in it. I originally picked this up because my brother became a volunteer firefighter and I wanted to understand some of the stuff he may be going through as part of that work. And being a medical sort myself, the EMS and paramedic chapter was amazing. There's one bit I'll never ever forget. It was an EMT or a paramedic who said, I have three rules in my ambulance. One, you do not spit in the back of my ambulance. Number two, you do not vomit in the back of my ambulance. And three, you do not die in the back of my ambulance when I'm back there with you. Great book. Let's move on to Industry with Semi Queer, Inside the Lives of Gay, Trans, and Black Truck Drivers by Anne Belay. And the trucking industry, the image, at least the image I have of it, is very white, male, kind of macho. But there are women, and there are trans folks, and there are queer folks, and people of color also driving trucks, and Belay takes a look at what it's like for them. Belay has driven trucks herself before she became an academic, and she's queer as well, so it really gives her an inside perspective on this. But even more than that, she quotes people at length and lets them tell their own story, which I find valuable. The trucking industry, I mean, it seems like, I don't want to say an easy job, but you go on the road, you drive, you come off, but there's so many things that have changed even in the past 10, 15 years, whether it be trucking regulations and those kinds of things that make it much harder. Even just the trauma that these people see on a regular basis, because when you're driving on the road every day, there's a higher chance you're going to either see an accident or maybe be in an accident or cause an accident and the trauma that provides. When you're on the road, let's say you're a diabetic and you need insulin, first of all, you need to keep it refrigerated, and you don't know where you're going to be at any particular time. So do you know that you're going to be able to come back home to pick up your next batch of insulin? All of those things. And there's a lot of talk about this male macho culture that is around the trucks and how that can turn out not very well for femme presenting folks and people of color and all these other different groups, immigrants and the rest. This opened my eyes to an industry that turns out I didn't know anything about. I thought I did, but I didn't. And it's such a wonderful look at what all these drivers are going through on a daily basis. The other book is Triangle, The Fire That Changed America by David Vondrell. And this is about a fire at the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory that happened on March 25th, 1911. And it was basically a sweatshop, and workers were literally locked into the building during working hours. A fire broke out, people couldn't escape because the doors were locked, and a bunch of people died. And because of this fire and the trial that happened after it, there were lots of changes to workplace laws, safety laws, and it was a really important event in that movement. And I do mean movements, because it covers the social movements, the political movements, the workers' movements of this time that were spurred on by the awful result of this fire and created change going forward in concrete ways. So it's both kind of small about the fire itself, about these larger issues. The second part is about the trial that followed all these fires, and it all works together incredibly well in creating a picture of what New York City was like at the time, because that's where this was, and just everything that came out from it. So if you're into history, if you're into any of these movements, if you're into, like, I like reading about disasters for some reason, I don't know, like, it fit in that for me. It's well done. For treatment, I have When We Do Harm, A Doctor Confronts Medical Error by Danielle Offrey. I love Offrey's writing. She's a doctor who writes about the human side of doctoring and how being a person with feelings and emotions and fallibilities works its way into medicine. And here she's looking at that last part. Why doctors make mistakes, how they make mistakes, and how they might be prevented. A lot of the literature on medical error concentrates on procedural error. So you have these things that need to be done in this order, and you mess one up, and therefore it's an error. But Offrey is looking at it from the more nebulous kinds of errors, like a patient comes to you with all of these symptoms. It could be 5 different things, but you end up diagnosing it as the wrong one. Why does that happen? How does that happen? And we hear about it not only through her own experience of being a doctor and working with things like the computerized charting systems that they all have, but also from the patient's point of view, because there are some narrative nonfiction parts in here talking about some cases that unfortunately did not end well because of medical error and how they came about and what can be done to fix them in the future. So while there's some not great stuff in here, like people die and bad things happen, she's very good about providing some solutions and some things you can do yourself if you find yourself a patient or a loved one is a patient to help in going forward. It is gut-wrenching in some parts. It is interesting and so well written and thoughtful and human. All of Offrey's writing is just so human, and I highly recommend it. I actually did a full review for it that I'll link up here and down below if you would like to hear more. I'm sticking with medicine for my other treatment book as well, and it's Invisible: How Young Women with Serious Health Issues Navigate Work, Relationships, and the Pressure to Seem Just Fine by Michelle Ann Hirsch. Young women who happen to have serious health issues often find themselves not believed. They're not believed by their doctors. They're like, oh, you're too young, you're too pretty, this possibly could happen to you. They're not believed by members of the public. There's a story of a woman who was using a crutch and couldn't get someone to give up their seat on the bus because they were too young to have had hip surgery, and all of the other issues that come up with that, including things at work, with relationships, and the rest. One of the many things I love about this book is the range of people that she speaks with. I mean, it's intersectional across race, religion, sexuality, gender, in an enlightening way. There's some people who consider themselves disabled. There are some who don't. We hear about why. And it was incredibly eye-opening and great writing as well. I go into more depth in a video where I talk about books covering chronic pain, both fiction and nonfiction. So if you'd like to hear more, I'll leave a link up here and down below. And as a quick bonus book for treatment, there's Know My Name by Chanel Miller. She was raped on the campus of Stanford University, and she goes through her own experience and how rape victims are treated by the legal system, by the people around them, by everyone. And it is harrowing, and again, so well written. So if feels so true to her own experience, and actually read this for the BookTube Prize nonfiction. It was in the finals last year, and I'll get more links to videos. For the last word, style, I have interpreted it in two completely different ways. We're going to start with Heartberries by Therese Marie Myatt. Myatt is from the Seabird Island Band, and she talks about what it's like growing up on a reservation, troubles at home, also relationships, medical diagnoses that she received. And this memoir, it's like she took the glass form of a memoir, smashed it at her feet, and then picked it up piece by piece and leaving everything in, little pieces of dirt, the blood from her hands. And it is poetic. It is raw. There are some parts, especially in the beginning, where it just, it soars. So if you're looking for something that takes style, like writing style, form, and breaks it up in an interesting way that will kind of blow the top of your head off, this is the book for you. And I have saved the most fun book for last. We are getting into some real style now with The Art of Drag by J. Call et al. And this is a book, it's full of illustrations done by several different illustrators, all of whom are queer. I believe some of them are drag performers as well, talking about drag as an art form and how it evolved over time in different places. That's what I loved about this, is that it's not all white, it's not all Western. It covers different parts of the world and all different kinds of drag traditions. We learn about drag in Thailand. We learn about the Takurazuka, which is a theater troupe here in Japan, where all of the roles, no matter the gender, are played by women. There are performers that I've never heard of before, and I ended up in YouTube rabbit holes searching for example, Lip Synca, who does some amazing lip syncing routines, and it is joy. It is joy. Just the bright colors, the wonderfulness that's on the page, as well as the information you learn and where it can lead you as far as rabbit holes go. So if you're looking for something fun, something delightful, this is the book for you. So those are my recommendations for this year's Nonfiction November. You can look forward to my own pile of possibilities, that's what I call a TBR, coming up later in the month. And I would love to hear from you if you'd like to read any of these books, if you have read any of these books, if you just want to say hi, let me know down in the comments below. Thank you for watching. Do subscribe if you're new so you don't miss anything. And I'll see you in the next video. Bye.